Seeing how hands together. Come on.
And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open.
Give God thanks this morning.
And I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. Working all things out, and yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy.
Your Bibles, take and turn with me this morning to the book of Philippians, and we're going to continue in our series walking through this book. We made it through 11 full verses last week, and so today we're going to pick up our reading in verse 12. While you're finding your place there, I rarely ever do this, but I want to just do this because I think it's important. I want to ask for you to pray for me as I will be traveling up to preach to a group of pastors tomorrow morning in Springfield, Missouri, at the Missouri Baptist Convention's Pastors Conference. I'll be preaching early in the morning. I don't know the exact time. I know it starts around 8:30-ish. And so I'll be the first guy up that morning. And why am I asking you to pray? I want you to pray because I am just really anticipating God doing something in a strong way there tomorrow morning. I have prayed for just burden for pastors. God has given me an inroad to minister to them. I've had a prayer ministry, as many of you know, for a number of years now for pastors. And there's hardly a week that goes by that I'm not speaking with another pastor that is deeply, and I want you to listen to me, deeply struggling with whether it be their church, whether it be issues at home, but they're hurting. And I really pray that God would use me tomorrow to be an encouragement to them and be that one that might, as Peter said in 2 Peter 1, that I am committed to reminding you of these things that the Spirit might stir you up. And I pray that that be what takes place tomorrow. So partner with me, if you would, and those men and their families as I go to preach there tomorrow morning. So this morning in Philippians chapter 1, I'm going to be speaking this morning on this subject, my attitude, my choice. My attitude, my choice. Now, you know as well as I know, before I ever say another word, we're not going to like this. I haven't liked it all week. I've struggled all week long in my preparation for this because it is, and I told Betts this morning, it's convicted me. It's deeply convicted me about how I see this man that we know as the Apostle Paul walking through some really challenging days, but yet he still is committed more than maybe ever in his life to be one that would preach the gospel in all seasons. And what's interesting is the song that did y'all like Lil Stevie's new song? Wasn't that good? Amen. I like that. Yes, I will. And it's interesting that he's bringing that up on this morning that I'm preaching on this, that we really have a choice to govern ourselves through our circumstances or allow our circumstances to govern us. And by the way, so you get, if you don't get anything else, get this, that is a choice. Many of you today would be sucked into the lie of believing that it's just because of your circumstances, you have no control whatsoever of what goes on in your life, that you're just a slave to that. Listen, that is a lie from hell. You may not have control over your circumstances, but you have control, bless God, by the power of the Spirit of the Lord Jesus that lives in you. You have control over you. It's one of the fruits of the Spirit of self-control. Amen. That includes our attitudes. And I don't like what I'm about to say, but here we go. All right? So if you found your spot there, won't you stand with me to honor the reading of the Word? I'm picking up our reading this morning in Philippians 1, starting in verse 12, if you found it. Say, here we go. The Bible says, "But I want you to know, brethren, that the things which happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel." It's a key verse in this whole pericope. It says, "So that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ even from envy and strife, and some also from goodwill. The former preach Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my chains. But the latter, out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And in this I rejoice, yes, and will rejoice. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Father, may you speak to us now all that we need to hear, and may we respond promptly to you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. So again, on the backdrop of the stage here, if you will, and I want you to hang on to this as we walk through here and see how this connects in your own life. My attitude, my choice. To set up the text, I want you to understand some things that are happening here. More than anything else, Paul, the man who we know now is in jail for preaching the gospel, not because he'd knocked over a liquor store or he'd beat his wife up, but he's in there because of preaching the gospel. His desire more than anything else as a missionary was to preach the gospel in Rome. This dude was laser focused on the fact, and had been so for some time, I must get to Rome. The hub of this great empire, which was Rome, was the key city of his day. All roads led there. If Paul could conquer it for Christ, it would mean reaching millions with the message of salvation. It was critically important on Paul's agenda. If you said, hey, Paul, give me your goals over the next 5-10 years, all of those goals would somehow connect to the city of Rome. He said, after I have been there, meaning Jerusalem, I must also see Rome, Acts 19:21. From Corinth, he wrote, so as much as in me is, I am ready and eager to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also. He wanted to go to Rome as a preacher. This is interesting to me, but he winds up going there as a prisoner. Isn't that interesting how sometimes that God takes the script and flips it on us? Wasn't it all what he had planned? And by the way, I think that some of you probably are living in situations right now that you'd say, this isn't what I had planned. I didn't see it happening like this. Anybody ever been in those moments? Am I talking to about four of you this morning? That it's just like, this is not what I dreamed of. This, gonna be quiet today. It's not what I dreamed of. It's not what my plans were. It's not what I had written down in my diary. It's not what, for you men, my man journal. Amen? It's not, I mean, because not many of us are keeping diaries, but man journals, okay? It's not what I had planned. Paul could have written an incredibly long letter. Matter of fact, Paul could have written quite an extensive book, all detailing the experiences that he had alone. Instead, yet what Paul does is he sums it all up in this one statement, the things which happened unto me in verse 12. And he says, and he gives this description of it, that it happened to be that which furthered the gospel. How can that be? How can a man that had dreams of going and standing before the emperor in Rome, leading this movement, this mass of people to faith in Christ in Rome, how could it be that that guy is now in jail, has no rights whatsoever, no freedom whatsoever, and yet he comes to this place of saying that it seems to me that everything that has happened to me has turned out for the furtherance of the gospel. Here's how. Rose prayed this a while ago. The single mind. Paul was the epitome of what we would call single-mindedness. All he wanted to do was to make sure that others came to know Christ. He didn't find joy in the fact that his circumstances were awful. He found joy in winning others to Jesus. And if his circumstances promoted the furtherance of gospel to him, that's all that mattered. The word here that he uses, I like this word in verse 12. The word furtherance means a pioneer advance. Warren Wiersbe said it like this. He said it's a Greek military term referring to the way that army engineers would go before the troops to open up the way into a new territory. So instead of finding himself confined as a prisoner, Paul discovered that his circumstances really opened up new areas of ministry. And I read that this week and I thought, my goodness, God, how would that radically change our lives? Rather than us looking at our circumstances as though I'm a prisoner to that, looking at that as though God is opening up door after door after door in my circumstances to make much of him. It's called redeeming the day. It's called redeeming the moment. And maybe it would even start with redeeming my tude. Because the thing that stops us, you don't have to say amen because I know you're not going to this morning. Maybe the very thing that stops us from redeeming those moments is because we have not started with redeeming our attitudes about them. This is a thing that convicted me deeply, and I'm just being transparent with you this morning. This is a thing that deeply convicted me this morning, or this week, as I'm reading with this, that he really had a great opportunity to pitch a fit. He really had an opportunity to complain. He really, had it been in our day, but he, no doubt, you know, you'd see, he'd have been tweeting about this, about how awful it was and needing some sympathy from the church, or he'd have wrote a blog about how the fact that the government in Rome was corrupt. But none of this is happening, obviously, and it's not because he didn't have Twitter, but it's because he had the single mind of saying that no matter what comes my way, I am determined more than ever that whatever happens, Jesus is going to be glorified. God sometimes uses some really strange tools, does he not, to help us to pioneer the gospel. In Paul's case, there are some tools that we see that allowed him even to reach this elite group of soldiers. It talks about that the whole palace guard, the Praetorian Guard, which is Caesar's special troops. This is the elite forces, the special forces. And God used these circumstances in Paul's life to help him to reach them. You see in the first few verses here, his chains were what helped him. His critics that came along afterwards helped him. His crisis of life that came along later helped him, all the while that all this is about preaching Jesus. So what I want to do is I want to show you just a couple of pictures here of Paul determining that his attitude was not going to get in the way. How did that happen? What did he do? So I want to give these to you. Number one, you see the picture of Paul as a messenger of hope. In verses 12 and 13, he says, "But I want you to know, brethren, the things which have happened to me," and I want you to focus on this word "actually." It says, "have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel." Why is the word "actually" there? Here's why. Because nobody saw it coming. In other words, you thought this was going to be something else. You thought that this was going to happen in a different way. What happens when a man goes to jail? Well, we're looking and saying, well, that's going to shut him up. That's what they were thinking. Well, we put him in jail. That's going to stop all of that. And Paul's saying, no, actually what happened was is that God used this to give me a platform that I never had without these chains to stand up and make much of Jesus. God, give us some of those kinds of attitudes in the church. And by the way, just so you don't think that Pastor Chad's being insensitive to your situation, that's not the case at all. I know your situations are tough. I know that some of you probably have situations, if we were to know the whole story, that would absolutely be heartbreaking, gut-wrenching to hear that. So I'm not making little of that. But what I am saying is this: we must be determined to not be slaves mentally and emotionally to those circumstances, but rather to redeem them by being committed before day one happens. Don't wait till you're in the moment of it. See, that's where we get messed up. We wait till we're in the middle of a crisis to begin to determine what we're going to be about and what we're going to do. Paul had the single mind before he ever became a prisoner to say, no matter what comes my way, Jesus, I'm going to make much of you wherever I go. I pray that God would raise up a generation of people, starting with me, that would say, I'm going to stop griping and complaining and dreaming about something different in regards of, God, would you change this? Would you change them? Would you change my situation? And rather start saying, God, would you change me, and start allowing me to make much of you. The same God, as some said it, that used Moses' rod, Gideon's pitchers, David's sling, used in the text Paul's chains. The Romans had intended his chains to be that which would tie him up and stop the message. But because Paul had trusted Jesus, his chains were used to free him up so that new opportunities to come and spread the message of hope in Jesus would take place. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 9, it says, Paul said, "He for which I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even to the point of chains, but the word of God is not chained." He didn't complain about his chains. Rather, he consecrated them to God. He asked God to use them for the pioneer advance of the gospel, and God answered his prayers. He answered them through a variety of ways. One, it gave him access to the lost. I like how he said this in verse 13, so that it's become evident to the whole palace guard and to the whole rest that my chains are in Christ. In other words, can you see this guy, this man Paul, he's chained up 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to a guard. And every 6 to 8 hours they come in and they change these guards out. And what Paul is saying now, it seems like every time that they come and they chain another one up, this dude gets to hear about Jesus. Man, could you send me another? I've told him everything I know. Give me another. So they give him another, and they chain him up. And what Paul is saying, you think that I am a prisoner? You're the one that's a prisoner. You can't get loose of me because I'm not shutting up. I'm just going to keep preaching. I'm just going to keep telling. Wait a second. Was he now all of a sudden free? No, he's as much of a prisoner as he's ever been. This guy, he has to be dependent on other people to come and bring him food and water. He has no rights. He doesn't get to go out and mingle around the city. He doesn't get to go see the sights. He has no money. As a matter of fact, you'd find that he has very few friends that are even coming to check on him. But yet he says, I've determined this is what I'm going to be about. You chain me up all you want. But the Word of God is as free as the Word of God has ever been free. And as long as I have breath in my lungs, I'm going to preach it and proclaim it until I am dead. Gave him access to the lost. Paul was able to hold both joy and sorrow at the same time. And you can see this in his letter to the Philippian church, as well as also in the Corinthian letters, in 2 Corinthians 6:10, where he describes himself as being sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. And so I want to be crystal clear on this point this morning when talking about your situation, when I'm saying I'm not being insensitive to that. Pain is real. Your grief is real. Your situation is real. And I'm not saying, hey, suck it up, buttercup. That's not what this message is about. But it's rather to say that in the midst of our pain, that we'd use our pain as a platform to propel the gospel rather than our pain as a weight to hold us down and to shut us up. And that's a choice. His maturity gave him strength when he faced intense suffering for the sake of the gospel. And by the way, if you start thinking, well, he was an apostle, he's a super Christian, all believers find the same capacity to endure hardship if we're focused on our trust in Christ. All of us have the same Holy Ghost within us. As a matter of fact, I'd say we have even more than the Apostle Paul. We have the entirety of the canon of Scripture that God uses to undergird and to give us promise and hope to hang on to. We learn to be content in our situation while not being content with our situation. We will become useful to Jesus. Let me say that one more time because I don't want you to miss that. When we become content in our situation, while not being content with our situation, we become useful for Jesus. You catch the picture, the difference there, right? There's a difference between being content in something without being content with that. I'm not content with the situation that I'm in, but while I'm in it, I'm going to be content within myself of saying that He is still Lord of all. He has not checked out on me. He's not went on vacation. He's not forgotten about my situation. He still sees me. And so all the while that we're praying and begging God, oh, please come and calm the storm around you, it may very well be that God's saying, I'm more interested in calming you in the midst of the storm. Sometimes God has to put chains on his people to get them to a place to accomplish this pioneering advance that could never happen in any other way. I understand because I'm one of these guys. I'm convinced that if everything would go the way I want it to, I'd still be as desperate for Jesus as I am today. I'm convinced of that in my own heart. You probably are too. In other words, Lord, if you'd give me $1 billion, I'd be as generous, maybe more, probably more than I've ever been. I'd be as joyful. I'd be sharing the gospel. I'm convinced of that. I'd at least like to try it. Amen, wouldn't you? Let's just test me, God, and see if I can handle crazy wealth. I mean, I'll be the guinea pig, okay? I'm convinced of that. I'm convinced that if all situations in my life were exactly as I wanted them ordered, that I'd still be doing what I'm doing and maybe even more. But here's the reality. Most of us could not handle all things going well. It's just us in here. Ain't nobody else with us. It's just us. We can be honest today. Most of us couldn't handle it. Most of us couldn't handle wealth. Most of us couldn't handle all things going smoothly. What often happens, our chains, you fill in the blank, whatever those are. Your chains may be what the doctor told you is wrong with you. Your chains may be relational issues. Your chains may be financial problems. Your chains could be a variety of different things. But it's often our chains that God uses to bring us to a place of desperation for His work in me, so that He might do a greater work through me. It's funny how our chains are all different, but yet they all wind up doing the same thing. Sometimes young mamas feel chained because of the fact that they're stuck at home with their babies and they have no other adults to talk to. When our babies were young, Bets was a stay-at-home mama. And I remember there were days that she was excited for me to come home, and it really had nothing to do with me other than the fact that she was tired of talking to babies and she wanted to talk to an adult. She would have settled for any one of you as much as me. It was just that there needed to be an adult in the room. And why you bring that up, preacher, here's why. Because sometimes mamas that are staying home with their baby, they feel chained as though that, well, I'm just stuck here raising this little brat that we've got. And man, it'd be nice if I could get it. Listen to me, ladies. I want you to hear this. God can use those chains as a platform for you to preach the gospel. And then sometimes you move later in life and you're chained by other issues. You may be chained because of your job. You may be chained because of an aging parent that you're providing for. You may be chained because of your financial resources not being what you thought that they would be. But the reality is, when we are faithful to God, God always, listen to me, He is always faithful to use our faithfulness to Him. Always. Susanna Wesley was the mother of 19 children. I just thought I'd at least hear an audible gasp across the room. 19 children. This is before the days of labor-saving devices and disposable diapers, girls. And yet, out of that large family, because of this woman's faithfulness to point her children Godward, we have this young John and Charles Wesley, who combined ministries literally shook the British Isles. At 6 weeks of age, Fanny Crosby was blinded, but even as a youngster had determined not to be confined by the chains of darkness, and yet in time, she became a mighty force of God through her hymns and gospel songs. What's interesting about Fanny's story is many of Fanny's songs have to do with sight. Isn't that interesting? Though many would look and see she is chained, I think Fanny's words were this, is that God has given her a vision that most people with sight will never have. The secret is this, is that when you possess a single mind, you look now in your circumstances rather than as burdens, but yet as God-given opportunities for the furtherance of the gospel. And you begin to rejoice at what God is doing rather than complaining about what He is not doing. Let me give you the second one. Have you noticed how quiet it is in here this morning? This is real life stuff, isn't it? As I read that all week long, the more I read it, I'm like, God, they ain't going to like this. Because this really puts a burden back. You know that life is so much easier for us. In this context, it's so much easier for us when we can blame somebody or something else rather than owning our situation. Amen. That's right, preacher. That's spot on. Isn't that true? Think about it. Because as long as I can blame, so if I can blame Brooks back here about my situation, well, whatever the situation is, if I can blame Pastor Brooks about that, then I can, rather than me doing something in it, because again, the context here is that I'm taking the situation God's given me, the chains He's given me, and saying, now this is my new platform. Rather than spending all my energy to get out of the situation, I'm spending my energy to glorify Jesus in that. But now I'm going to blame Pastor Brooks for my chains, my situation. And now what happens is I come to a place of even self-pity. I come to a place of blame and a place where my spirit just gets dirty. It gets heavy. And my effectiveness goes out the door. Well, what's the big change in it? The big change is my attitude and my choice and how I lead my attitude. And I understand as I'm saying this to you, because y'all are looking about half mad this morning about this. This is hard. There is nothing easy about what I'm talking. And by the way, if you conquer it today, hey, get ready. Tomorrow's going to be hard too. This is not one of those moments where you know, some lessons in life, you just learn them and it's just like, check, got that one. This is the one you check every day for the rest of your life. Do you see me still? I don't know why I'm still checking, but I'm checking. You keep checking this. Why? He's not done. If you're breathing, you're not done. Did I go to number two yet? Here it is, and then we'll be done soon. Number one was we see Paul as a messenger of hope. Number two, we see Paul as a motivator for Christians. In verse 14 down through 16, it says, "And most of the brethren of the Lord, having become confident in my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear." This is interesting. Many of the believers in Rome had now become bold in their faith as they saw Paul suffering. This reminds you of a truth that God just helped me with this week. It may very well be that the chains that you're dealing with have not as much to do with you as they do around to those that are around you and watching you. You ever think of that? Your situation you're going through may be more for the people that are in your life than they are for you yourself. The Bible says that they were much more bold to speak the word without fear. That word speak, by the way, does not mean preach. So if you're taking this as, well, okay, they all turned out to be great preachers. That it's not the word preach. It's the word that literally means everyday conversation. So in other words, because of the preacher's chains that he was dealing with and his faithfulness to preach Christ, now the church that's watching him in their everyday life, they're going to check in. The one's going to be a plumber today. The other's going to teach school today. The other's going as a police officer today. But in their everyday conversation, now they have this new boldness. Why? Because the preacher's up here suffering in prison for preaching the gospel. One of the keys to maximizing our chains is to understand that it's not just for me, but for those to whom I have the privilege of reaching with the gospel. Let me give you the last one. We'll be done. That one went really quick. Amen. Y'all okay? You like quick ones. Number three, we see Paul as the magnifier of Jesus. Here again, what we're building here is a picture of what we desire to be. I want to make much of. I don't want to be that guy that at the end of my life, that we're talking more about my circumstances than we are talking about the one I've given my life to. I've got one life to live, that's all. I don't get a redo to make a difference for others. Why say that? Here's why. You can spend your entire life wasting opportunities to invest in other people, all the while blaming your circumstance. Your life. Well, If I had a different family, my family's mean. You'd be amazed. I mean, people just believe that if they had a better family, then they could do more for Jesus. If I had a better job. I did this once right after I got saved. And you ever have those moments in your life that seemed right at the time, but after you got past them, you look back and you go, what a dummy. Am I the only one? Me and Scott. That's it. So two of us. Right after I got saved, I was so fired up about Jesus. And by the way, just so you know, I haven't gotten over that. But I was pumped. My wife will tell you. And I know I had to be annoying because it was just, it was oozing out of me, and I was running as hard as I knew how to run. I was trying to tell everybody I could tell about Jesus and win the whole world. I thought that whole win the world, the Jesus thing was mine. Not the church, it was mine, and I was going to do it. And so times were tough financially, and man, I was working 3 jobs trying to make ends meet, and I got this new job as a welder building aluminum horse trailers. That's what my job was. What? Yes, aluminum. Aluminum horse trailers. My wife is trying to interrupt me by being critical. And I'm not going to let the critics get me down this morning, okay? So I've got this new job. It's the only, to this day, that I can recall, it's the only job I've ever been fired. Any of y'all ever been, don't point, but you ever been fired? That is a humbling thing. And I wasn't fired because I was a bad welder. I kind of grew up, my dad had heavy equipment, and you didn't have a bulldozer without knowing how to weld. So as a little bitty boy, I knew how to weld. And so the work wasn't the deal. The problem was my own attitude. And remember, I'm a new Christian. I want to reach people with Jesus. But when I got in there, and I'm working night shift because I'm working another job or two during the day, and so I'm checking in at about 10 o'clock at night, somewhere in there, and I work all through the night welding on these stupid trailers. I was the most miserable I think I'd ever been. I worked there for, I don't remember how many days, but it was days. It wasn't weeks. It was days before I got fired. And here was the problem. Don't judge me. I already feel your judgment starting. I got in there, and there wasn't a single Christian in the building. And they played this wild, loud, hippie rock music. Okay? I'm a country boy, bless God. Okay? I'm all I listen to is good Christian music like Waylon and Willie and the boys. Amen? That's what I was used to. That's what I kind of got weaned on. And they're playing this wild, hippie, loud music. And all I could think about, I got to get out of this stinking job away from these crazy people and their crazy music so I can go serve Jesus full time. I knew you were going to judge me. You're doing it right now. Well, why didn't you? I don't know why I didn't win those guys to Jesus. I wasn't concerned about those. Why? I saw it as my chains. This is what's holding me back. This is what's keeping me from being all I could be for Jesus. And so I'm coming home miserable. If I could just get out where I could go do something for Jesus. And yet Jesus has locked me up with these lost dudes and their wild, loud, hippie music. Armed with the gospel. And I could not see the forest for the trees. I was the polar opposite of Paul the Apostle. And I don't know, I think this may be the first time I've ever told that story in public. Can I tell you why? It's a blot on my life. Maybe one of the most embarrassing things I've ever done. Number one, as a man, you don't get fired because you're not doing your job. My daddy taught me to work and work hard, and I can't believe I got fired. But it taught me a life lesson that I've never gotten past. That in all and every situation that comes along in my life, whether it is something that I feel is chaining me down or something that is setting me free, my attitude is my choice. How I deal with it is my choice. The situation may not be, but my attitude and how I deal with it, how I function in it, is my choice. And what could have happened is I could have determined that dark place, yes. Loud, wild, hippie music, yes. That's all I could remember from that. I can't even tell you the guys' names because that stinking, wild, loud, hippie music. What a difference I could have made for the sake of the gospel. Preacher, why tell that story? Because it may just be that some of you are in that job. It may not be wild, loud, hippie music, but it may be a job you feel like you're chained with. Man, if I could just get out of this, I could boom, 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 whatever the case may be. Yours may be a life situation, something with family. It may be something with finances. It may be your health. But the reality is, it all comes back to this one statement. My attitude is my choice. Paul is determined, whether dealing with his critics, his chains, or his crisis, I am going to magnify the Lord. He was able to rejoice not in the selfishness of these others, but in the fact that Christ was being preached, because some came and began to preach Christ in such a way that they were trying to add to the affliction to cause more pain. And by the way, that thing still happens today. We get jealous of others, so therefore we spread gossip and dissension about others. And Paul's attitude, he could have got up and really pitched a fit. He could have really got up and got even. But no, Paul was saying, as long as people are coming to faith in Christ, say what you will about me, it's not about me. There was no envy in his heart. It mattered not that some were against him. All that mattered was the preaching of the gospel. I'll read you this story and I'll close. I thought this was interesting. As a matter of historical fact and record, that the two great English evangelists, John Wesley and George Whitefield, disagreed strongly on doctrinal matters. Now, I've always found this interesting, that whenever we disagree about Fords and Chevys, we can still get along and be buddies. But if we have any doctrinal differences, we have to be enemies for some reason. But they disagreed strongly. Both of them were very successful, preaching to thousands and tens of thousands, seeing multitudes come to Christ. It was reported that one day, while being interviewed, someone had asked Wesley if he had expected to see Whitefield in heaven. And Wesley said, absolutely not. Well, do you not think that Whitefield is a converted man? Of course he's a converted man, Wesley said, but I don't expect to see him there because he will be so close to the throne of God and I so far away, I'll not be able to lay eyes upon him. Though he differed with his brother in some matters, Wesley did not have envy in his heart, nor did he seek to oppose this great man's ministry. The only and best way to deal with criticism is to possess a single mind, to make for certain that in all things Christ Jesus is magnified. If we are not careful, in the midst of our chains, our pain, our situation, one of the greatest lies of the devil, better yet, one of the tactics he uses, is to cause us, rather than to look to Christ, to look to others. Your preacher has been guilty of this. So easy in the midst of a situation that I don't like to start to look to others and try to... Have you ever noticed, by the way, whenever you're in a situation, it seems that nobody else is? Am I the only one? Have you ever noticed that? I'm just some homework. Next time you and your bride or gals, you and your husband are fighting, isn't it interesting that on those days that it seems like everybody else has now all of a sudden landed with a perfect marriage? I guess we're the only ones. The moment, I'm telling you, the moment Betsy and I start fussing with one another, all of a sudden, every man on the planet is the most romantical man that there ever was. Because I'm not. And the moment that we start to fuss, every wife out there is the most encouraging and sweet and kind and understanding and blessed woman that a man could ever be married to. Why do we see those things? It's because the moment that the enemy gets us distracted from our situation in Christ onto other or other people in theirs, we stop dealing with ours, all the while longing and coveting to have theirs. Friends, don't get sucked into that trap. Be determined today that your situation can be redeemed for the glory of Jesus and the propagating of the gospel.